Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Frostbite by Adrienne Woods, narrated by Erin Moon. Epitome. Death was my constant companion. I'd escaped its icy clutches 3 times during my short life. My first brush with the spirit I now knew as death was the night I learned who my father truly was. The night I witnessed his transformation into a dragon on Interstate 40, and the night we were attacked by dragons. I lost my hero that night, and my world was turned completely upside down when I was whisked away to Paegeia, a world where dragons and magic exist, a world located inside the Bermuda Triangle, hidden from the human realm behind a magical wall. Humans have the ability to penetrate the wall, but if they try to exit Paegeia, they are instantly disintegrated. I used to call it my one-way ticket to Neverland. Now it has become my home. While the wall may be limiting to humans, dragons are free to come and go as they please, and they've done so for the past 900 years. Hiding among the human race to protect the weak, help the poor, and trade with the rest of the world. The second time I almost died was right after I received my foretelling from the Viden. Foretellings are a type of prophecy intended to lead the people of Paegeia to their destinies, but the Viden gives them in a messed up way, in the form of a riddle. Mine could mean anything. But I knew now that it would only bring death. What the words in my foretelling meant, I still needed to figure out. The question was, would it be worth it? The first time I thought I had figured out my destiny was when I went to retrieve the King of Lions' sword. It was formidable, magical, and could slay evil in any form. Brian, a sunburst dragon, died saving my life and the lives of my friends, who were dumb enough to follow me into the madness. The second time I had the chance to fulfill the twisted words of the opaque riddle was when I had the opportunity to claim Paul, a wavern, to prove once and for all that wavern's had the capacity to be good like all the other dragons. Once again, I was wrong, and my only love, Lucian, paid the ultimate price. He died saving my life, but not before I turned into a dragon myself. I was a dragon. I had always been a dragon, and I had never known. It was still a mystery why I hadn't been able to shift before, and they were still studying why only my anger and fear had brought on the change. To be honest, I didn't care about my foretelling anymore. People I loved had died, and I couldn't stop feeling as if all of this was my fault. Losing Lucian had taken a huge toll on me. I didn't want to live. But for some reason, now that I wanted to die, the spirit of death didn't come to claim his prize. Instead, I was left with a hollow feeling deep inside my chest, one that would never be filled. I was left with a broken heart, ice cold, as if no amount of heat could ever warm me again. Ariana is right. I am like poison. No, not poison. The people in my life, the ones I love, didn't die from my touch. Their deaths were written in the choices I made. All of them were on death's list, waiting for the day they would take their last breath. I'd paralyzed their lives, their futures. I was like ice, like frost, freezing their hopes and dreams. I was the living embodiment of frostbite. 1. I was back inside that cave, the one where Lucian had lost his life. I looked around, but I knew he wasn't going to come for me. He was dead. Then what the hell am I still doing here, staring at a psycho who claims to be my dragon? You really thought I was your dragon, Elena? Seriously? He laughed that sadistic laugh that made my insides twist and turn in all directions. Get away from me, you freak! I spat. His hand connected hard against my cheek. It burned and my ears rang for a couple of seconds. I'm not a freak. I'm a patriot. Patriot? I laughed as loud as I could. You are a murderer! Another strike. The elementals clucked like crazy. They could feel the danger all around them and must have felt helpless. It was beginning to drive me insane. Stop it, you mongrels, or I'll skin you alive! Paul screamed, and for some reason they listened. He looked back down at me again. The point of his knife was close to my throat. It's funny how everyone around you knows who you are, Elena. Except you. What are you talking about? He laughed again. I guess they like to play mind games with you, like to keep you in the dark. His eyes met mine. Some friends you have. Stop that! You know nothing about my friends or what friendship is. Why? Because they all end up betraying you at the end of the day. Take it from me. It's better to live in the dark. You can do whatever you want, be whatever you want. Your friends don't give a shit about you, and neither does your dragon. You are not my dragon. Oh, I know that. And for some sick, twisted reason, your true dragon wasn't bothered one bit that I claimed you as my rider. You are lying. Am I? He looked around. Then where is your dragon, Elena? Why isn't it here? The elementals' clucking noises drowned the rest of Paul's words. I could see his lips moving, but their sounds of pure panic drilled through my brain, making it impossible to hear what he had to say. It grew louder and louder, and then a cannon shot ran through their cries. I jumped up in bed, soaked with sweat. It was like the gazillionth time I'd had that dream. I could still hear their clucking, and it made me feel as if I was going crazy. But still, no tears came. My heart felt as if it was bouncing inside my ears. No matter how many times I had the same dream, I could never hear Paul's last words as the elemental sounds kept interrupting him. But there was one thing that I knew was a lie. I didn't own a dragon. I was a dragon. And that was one piece of information I still struggled to deal with. Elena, you need to focus. Put all your strength and emotions into one place and see your dragon, Sir Edward, the professor who taught transformations inside the Colosseum, said. See who you truly are, and the shift will come naturally. I shook my head at his words. I don't like the way she makes me feel. It is who you are, he said. It's not, I yelled at him. Here we go again. A chirp came from Amy, a night villain. Glaring at her, I couldn't help thinking how much I would love to zap her ass right now. The others just gave me slight shakes and eye rolls as they stared at me in disgust. They didn't understand how I could possibly not want to embrace my dragon. When their stares became too much, I turned around and ran out of the arena. Elena! Sir Edward called after me. He could yell as much as he wanted. I knew starting with dragon classes would be a waste of time. I wasn't a dragon, I couldn't be one. For the love of blueberries, I was afraid of heights. Trees flew past me and I ran toward the wooden door that led to the school. I glanced at the Parthenon dome quickly before I ran up the stairs. I loved that dome and would give anything to put my trust in my two axes rather than rely on my purple lightning. Or to accept her, the being coiling inside of me, begging to be released. I couldn't grant her that wish because she was too unpredictable, and I never knew what the hell she was going to do when she came out. It was like when I became the dragon, I turned into Hyde, a monster that would destroy anyone, no matter if it was foe or friend. I opened the wooden door with a flick of my wrist, as if the hulking oak weighed nothing, then made it around the first corner fast and rested against the wall as I tried to catch my breath. I hadn't been lying when I said I didn't like the way she made me feel. The anger and frustration of not being able to save him that day was 10 times worse whenever I shifted into her. The pain and the heartache of losing Lucian were unbearable. It drove her. She wanted to kill. And if Sammy and George hadn't been near me the second time I'd shifted into her, an innocent soul would have paid the price. I wanted revenge so badly. But how did you kill a ghost and his hippogriff girlfriend? Paul had died that day. He deserved it. But another thing I struggled with was with knowing for sure. The love of his life, Nora Giorgio, a shape-shifting hippogriff who'd pretended to be our enchantments professor a few months back, hadn't cried out in agony when he went up in golden dust. I'd also heard the word drink, and my mind jumped to one conclusion: a potion. Lucian's iron blade had killed him. It was the only type of metal that could kill a wavern. And yet, I had a funny feeling that she had found a way to save his life. How, I still needed to figure out, since I couldn't go and ask around if there was a way to save someone's life if they were mere inches from death. If a method like that existed, I was sure it would be forbidden, something that Paegeia wouldn't cast, even if the king's life depended on it. And if such a potion did exist, I would be the fool. So, I'd been trying to search for the answer myself, with little success. If one of the library books did contain the information, I hadn't found it yet. The internet threw out potions in the search results that didn't make any sense. Most of them were healing potions, but none of them were what I was looking for. The other reason I'd been searching to find out whether it existed was in the hopes that I could find a way to bring back Lucian. If I found the potion, I wouldn't even think twice about it. I couldn't live without him, and thinking about him made me want to bawl my eyes out again as the ache in my heart crept into my bones and blood. But since my dragon had come forth, I couldn't show that emotion. There were just no more tears. The last time I'd cried was the day Lucian died. I guess, in some way, I'd gotten my wish of never wanting to cry again. I just never imagined it would come in the form of a purple dragon. Pressing my back against the cold stone wall, I let my knees give out. I hugged my knees after my butt found the cold surface of the floor and rocked. As I sat, I could hear footsteps and breathing as someone approached. A strong fragrance of vanilla and roasted almonds followed. Yes, something else that had been enhanced was my sense of smell, and I knew it was Sammy. The sound of her approach came closer and closer until it sounded as if she was inside of me. My friend reached down and wrapped her arms around me. She wore the same robe as me. It was a piece of clothing that dragons would throw over their human forms after they transformed back. It was nothing special, but I clung on to it, because I didn't like being naked in front of everyone. It was the one thing I would never get used to. Sammy was one of my best friends, and had been with me on every life-threatening experience I'd encountered since I came to Paegeia.
"Elena, you need to try."
I looked at her. "Sammy, I can't. Look what happened the last time."
"It's normal. You're grieving, and you want justice like all of us, including your dragon form. She sat next to me. We experience emotions on a different level, a more intense one, and I don't know if you will ever get used to it, but you are what you are, Elena. You can't deny her.
I sighed as I stared at the floor.
I thought I was done with the questions, but I can't forget them. I can't forget him. Why didn't he tell me?
I was speaking about my father. How many things had he hidden from me?
I don't know.
Her lips arched downward, and she had a huge frown between her eyebrows.
I wish so badly that there was something that I could tell you that could make all of this easier on you. But there isn't. Being a dragon is hard, Elena, for all of us. But it's who we are, and we have to embrace it.
What if I'm like the chromatic, Sammy? I don't want to be beaten. She grabbed me around the neck.
You're not. Master Longway said that thunderlights are good, remember?
Then why do I feel so evil?
You're not evil. You lost someone you love in a messed up way. It's bound to make you feel angry and frustrated because his killer is still out there. You want justice. That's what you're feeling. Not getting it made you do what you almost did the last time. It's not who you are. You're just experiencing the emotion of that loss and want justice on a more intense level.
She said the same thing again, as if I didn't get it the first time. The bell rang and she stared at me with soft eyes, eyes that pleaded with me to open my mind and just accept things the way they were. When students started to pass us, I sighed. She made sense, but I still didn't want to feel that pain and anger. It was too much, and my thunderlight would just have to stay trapped inside this human form a little longer.
Come, let's go and see what Chef has made for lunch.
She reached for my hand after she got up and pulled me to my feet in one swift movement. We entered the cafeteria, and my back connected hard with the wall. Amy's long and pointy nose almost touched mine. Her fist clutched my robe, and with her night villain strength, she lifted me almost off the floor. Her two buddies held Sammy tight.
Leave her alone, Amy!
Sammy, shush! I'm doing this for all of us! She snapped at Sammy over her shoulder before her head shot back around to face me. Just move on, Watkins, she spat, and I could feel her acid saliva spray gently onto my face. It burned slightly, and I ground on my teeth to stop myself from showing my pain. Still, it didn't burn as much as I thought it would. Get your paws off of me, I replied through clenched teeth. You're pathetic. Ariana was right. Lucian wasted his life saving yours. The two girls who held Sammy snickered.
Amy, shut up,
Sammy shouted. No, she was right, and I totally agreed with Amy's last statement, though my thunderlight didn't. She got mad, and when I opened my mouth again, she cussed like crazy. The voice wasn't mine anymore, and Amy let go of my robe and started to back off. When she became smaller, I knew exactly what was happening, and there was absolutely nothing I could do to stop it. The tables close to us crushed into splinters underneath my dragon weight. Pillows that came in contact with my talons tore into pieces, and sponge popped out everywhere around me. Huge scaly paws tore free from my skin, and I didn't care about the robe on my body that shredded into a million pieces, lying in a pathetic heap on the floor. I only concentrated on calming myself down as anger burned through my veins and revenge warmed my belly. If I killed Amy today, Master Longway would surely throw my ass out of here. The walls started to shake, and the students, who were inside the cafeteria, made their way outside in total hysteria.
Elena, deep breaths. Calm yourself.
Chef was in front of me with his hands up in defense. He had to arch his neck, and he made his voice louder as he spoke the words.
Do as he says, Elena. Calm down,
Sammy shouted from below on my other side.
Should I turn?
She asked Chef softly, but whispers were loud to my sensitive ears.
No, it might only rile her up more.
The opposite wall and roof came closer, and I wished I could stop growing. What was going on? I was big, but never this big. The pain from the lightning burned my stomach, and I had to release it.
She's going to blow,
Chef yelled. Called out as Sir Edward stormed into the cafeteria. A purple lightning bolt hit the wall. Bricks spattered, and more light from outside streamed in. For some reason, the word escape played around inside my head. Students popped their heads inside the newly formed hole, nosy little brats. They flinched away fast as a second bolt exited my mouth. This was exactly what had happened the last time. It began with me not wanting to breathe lightning on them, but the minute I started, I couldn't stop. Or, let me rephrase, I didn't want to stop. I would see Paul in all of them, and in less than a minute, I was going to forget that my name was Elena, and I would become her, destroying everyone in my path, even my friends. That last thought was barely through my mind when everything around me went black. Kara. I found myself in a confined space, little insignificant rodents on two legs scattered around me. An urge to scorch their asses developed deep inside my gut, and my thunder coiled inside my belly. Two of them spoke to me, calling me Elena. Who the hell is Elena? I blew one with my lightning and growled as an intense pain moved through my body. I looked down and watched in horror as my talons changed length and the scales on my paws turned a deeper purple, almost red. My snout burned like fire as a stabbing and tearing agony shot along my jawline. The small rodents were yelling orders to put out the flames, and I heard the sound of magic killing my thunder. I looked up as the pain vanished to see the last bit of my purple thunder being destroyed. The only thing was, it wasn't a purple fire they were trying to put out, but a pink one. The small rodents on their two legs gasped, and the one with pale long hair had gotten away from my earlier blast. I breathed another, and a second pain tore through my belly. This time purple thunder didn't come out, but a fire so strong it felt as if it was going to disintegrate my core. I caught a part of my reflection in broken glass pieces on the floor, and an ugly purple mutt with sprouts hanging from its chin was reflected back at me. That mutt didn't belong to me, and the fear of what was happening became stronger than my revenge. The only thing I knew was that if I didn't get away, they would trap me and destroy whatever I'd become. I took flight, and more walls came crashing down. I pushed myself up through the roof, and what I thought would leave a mother of a headache only left a small twinge as I blasted through the brick. It felt as if the change had made me stronger, and my endurance for pain had increased. Still, the fear of what they could do to me was overpowering my being. I didn't know that fire. I didn't trust it. And Mama always told me not to trust the things you didn't know. Mama, what happened to her? Where is she in all of this? Why have I been asleep for so long? The wind beneath my wings was unstable. I felt woozy, as if I'd forgotten how to fly. Everything tumbled down, and I couldn't remember anything she'd taught me. Not that any of it mattered. A shrill screeching sounded behind me, and I turned my gaze to see who dared to follow me. It was another dragon, brass in color, and it flew fast in my direction. It let out another shrill scream, and anger heated up the new flame that was burning my throat. I opened my mouth and breathed the pink fire again. The dragon missed it by an inch and froze in midair. "Keep your distance," was the thought that went through my mind. I didn't want to hurt whoever that was, but I was behind enemy lines and none of this looked familiar. I was far from home. I tried to remember what Mama had told me about flying and dove forward, but I ended up in a tumble and couldn't regain my balance. These weren't my wings. This wasn't my body. This was nothing like me. A deep sadness at the reality of not being able to remember anything crept into the core of my heart, and I didn't see the treetops. One hit me straight in the face and another connected with my entire body. I came crashing down as more trees fell, and roots and vines tangled in my talons and around my body. When I came to a stop, I tried to move, but it was no use. I wanted to breathe fire again. But I stopped as my instinct told me that I would burn this entire forest down with me trapped inside. I inhaled deeply and tried hard to control myself. With every breath, I felt as though I could think more clearly. My heart rate decreased, and the burning sensation that coiled inside my body began to cool. An ache for someone was the only emotion that stayed with me. And then, everything started to fade.
2. Elena. My eyes were closed, and a deep, raspy breathing filled the silence around me. My body ached, and the intensity of the sounds assaulting my sensitive ears told me I was still in my dragon form. What the hell happened, and where I was, I didn't know. My memory was all a blur after Amy pushed me against the wall and I began speaking to her in that horrible voice, releasing that first bolt of purple lightning. I tried to recall my thoughts, and it slowly came back to me in flashes. I'd changed. The picture that formed inside my mind wasn't the thunderlight that had been reflected back to me from the glass that lay on the floor. It was the face of another dragon. Dark and dangerous. I turned to see the colored scales on my paw and found a deep purple red reflecting back. The Rubicon. No, this can't be. I tried to move but was trapped. I couldn't turn or break free from whatever held me to the ground, and that stirred more panic within me. I froze as I heard a voice. The beast inside of me wanted to take over again, and whatever it wanted to do, it wasn't good. I'd known that from the beginning, and nobody had wanted to believe me. I could hear three hearts beating, and even more voices spoke softly to one another.
What the fuck? Watch your language, Blake,
a man said sternly.
Just be careful. Sir Edward says that she is a Rubicon,
a woman said frantically.
Oh, come on. Only one Rubicon can live at a time, Constance.
I'm just repeating what Sir Edward said.
I growled as they came nearer.
She's here,
the one who'd sworn called close to my side, and I growled all the more.
Is she okay?
The woman asked. I shouldn't be afraid of them, but I was. It was such a strange feeling. This happened every time I became her. I wouldn't remember anything, and I didn't know if they were friends or enemies. In another 5 minutes, give or take, everything would come back, but I didn't have 5 minutes. They were here now. My heart was pounding and I couldn't calm it down. My belly warmed up and the lightning burned inside my throat once again.
I tried my best to contain it as my dragon eyes took in the tall trees surrounding me. One blast of lightning would set this entire forest aflame, and I would surely die, choking in the suffocating smoke of my own rage and fear.
She's still in her dragon form.
The voice was right behind me now.
Elena?
He spoke gently. I couldn't turn around. My body was in a lot of pain, and the lightning coiled inside my stomach like a viper begging for a reason to strike. Stop this, I said loud inside my mind, but it just kept boiling. Trying to control it made it worse, and the pain was so intense it felt as if I was going to explode. The guy laughed near me, but it wasn't him anymore. It was Paul. For some reason, I always remembered Paul. He came into sight.
Look at you, a dragon, and not just any dragon, another Rubicon. Gorin is going to be pleased, Elena.
Another Rubicon? How can this be? The heat in my body rose a few degrees, and I released my purple lightning. The only problem was, it wasn't purple. It was a vibrant pink fire. Paul blocked it with an invisible force, and the flames backfired onto my scales. It felt warm, familiar. He came closer and grabbed me by the whiskers that had sprung out of my chin. Whiskers I'd never had. Then he laughed again. I released another breath, but he froze my fire. His facial features slowly began to morph into the face I had seen before it had turned into Paul. Blake? Everything came back in a split-second wave crashing over me.
I'm sorry,
I said, and the green of the trees became brighter. My skin was soaking up an invisible cloak.
Are you calm?
Blake asked. I nodded my ugly head, but the whiskers he had a firm grip on hurt my chin.
I'm scared,
I whispered back in my deep voice. Constance and Master Longway came into view, and my fear evaporated as I recognized them.
Why can't I control her?
Oh no. I dug my head into my paws as Sammy's figure jumped into my mind. I'd blown fire at her when she'd tried to follow me. I'd almost killed my best friend. Whimpering left my body, reminding me of the calls made between whales, a sound that always brought me to tears.
Are you sure you are calm?
Blake asked.
She's calm, Blake. We need to get her out of this, Constance said, and for the next while they spoke all sorts of incantations, and the grip the roots and vines had on me started to weaken. When I was finally free, Blake spoke again.
Can you move?
I didn't answer. They should just leave me here. I couldn't face Sammy or what I'd done to the cafeteria.
Look at me,
he demanded. I didn't do what he asked.
Elena, look at me,
he shouted this time.
No!
His footsteps approached. He grabbed my whiskers again and turned my head by force to look at him. It didn't even hurt this time. He stared at me for a short while. Then something I'd never seen before emerged in his eyes. It was as if he'd finally found the answers to all his problems. His mouth curved slightly upwards. He really was so beautiful. The slight curve of his lips transformed into his million-dollar smile, one I'd only seen that first day my eyes had fallen on him, the same one that resembled my father's, and the one that would make every girl turn to goop on the spot. Blake helped me, like the last time I'd had to transform back into my human form. It still wasn't easy, as the shift was just as painful as the changing into a dragon part. It became a bit easier, though, to clear my mind when he was near. Constance covered my naked body with a robe the minute my human figure resurfaced, and all the scales and talons were gone. When I lifted my head slowly, I found Blake still sitting on his haunches in front of me. "Thanks," I mumbled, and clutched the robe tighter around my body.
"You're welcome,"
he chuckled again, ending it with a huff that looked down at the floor for a second. The expression of what I'd seen earlier in his eyes became evident on his face. He stood and walked toward Master Longway. Constance helped me up, and the woods that had looked so small before gave me the opposite impression now. Most of the trees around us lay flat, bent at their trunks in a sort of sad bow. We had to climb over them to get out of the woods, and I closed my eyes to the destruction around me. This could never happen again. Constance stayed close to me and carried most of my weight as we walked. I felt drained and tired, as if I could sleep for a whole month. My eyes found hers and she gave me a soft smile and a squeeze. How had everything gotten so messed up? I wasn't just a dragon. I was a Rubicon. Nothing made sense. How can there be one special dragon for the light that can turn into a dragon meant for the dark? "I thought only one Rubicon lived at a time," I whispered to Constance.
"That's true, but ever since you came to Paegeia, Elena, plenty of things have happened that we just don't have answers for,"
Constance said quietly.
"Yay me,"
I said, sulking. She giggled quietly.
"See? You're almost back to normal."
It was silent for a while as we tried to find a way out of the woods.
"It's not so bad. You'll get used to her,"
Constance tried to reassure me. "I don't think it's the getting used to her part I should be worrying about." I sighed and found Constance's worried gaze on me again.
"It's hard to explain. When I'm her,"
I sighed again,
"when she takes over, I don't know what I'm doing."
Constance smiled.
"Ever heard the term Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde?"
I nodded.
"It's exactly like that." "It's normal, Elena. You'll remember more every time you turn, and the procedure will come faster, too. The rest, well, there is only one dragon who can really help you with that,"
she said, and nodded toward Blake, who walked right next to Master Longway, speaking in Latin. He despised every hair on my body, yet today he'd showed me some kindness, some sympathy.
"Will I become evil too?"
Constance's eyes glistened, and she looked away.
"I don't know, Elena. Only time will tell."
I bit the inside of my lip and nodded again. We eventually reached the edge of the forest, and I had to admit my dragon form was really fierce and had taken a third of the forest down with her. Blake removed his robe and I looked away. The change came so naturally to him, and when I heard the tear and pop sound, I knew he'd transformed into a dragon. Constance looked at me. I shook my head.
"I can't." "Okay."
She smiled, took off her robe, and walked away from me to transform. She was such a beautiful dragon. Her silver scales shimmered in the last ray of sunlight, almost blinding me as they reflected at just the right angle. Her long neck made her look majestic, and she had a small white beard right below her chin. Her swallow wings were my favorite feature. She held out her paw, and I grabbed it, using her talons to stand. She lifted off, and as soon as the ground was a few paces below me, I closed my eyes. My heart beat like crazy as she pulled me closer to her body. Her leathery torso felt warm, soft, and she smelled clean, like the forest. I tried to listen for her heartbeat, but could barely hear it. Funny how everything about them was so different from us. I took a deep breath. You're a dragon, Elena. We landed back on Dragonia Academy turf half an hour later. I gave Constance a hug after she shifted back into her human form, and thanked Blake awkwardly as he stood, butt naked, with his robes hanging over his arm, still speaking to Master Longway. He had absolutely no shame when it came to his naked body. None of them did, and I doubted it was going to be that easy for me. When I entered my room, Sammy grabbed me around my neck. My arms started to shake, and I didn't know if it was the reality of me almost killing her that had finally kicked in. I'm so sorry. Shh, I'm perfectly fine. Not even a hair was harmed. I could have killed you, Sammy. Hey, my brother is a Rubicon. He taught me well. She had a huge grin, but for some reason, I didn't see the humor in it. So, you're a Rubicon, Becky said right behind me. I turned around. I didn't try by any chance to zap your ass too, right? She shook her head and laughed. George and I are way too fast. Be careful. This room might be too small for that head of yours, Sammy said. Whatever, Becky sang. The vibe that had emerged from their constant fighting ever since I'd turned into a dragon grew thicker with each silent second. It felt as if it was going to drown me. I shook my head slightly. Can you guys just please stop? I begged. This has been going on for far too long. I'll try to embrace this if you guys just go back to normal, okay? I looked at both of them. Ever since I'd become a dragon, I'd struggled with accepting it. Sammy had given me space, but Becky, well, she was being Becky. We fought a lot, and she would tell me that I was a coward for not accepting it. To her, being a dragon was hot, and she would have given anything to be one. Sammy didn't like Becky's way of helping me deal with this, and where she was usually soft and laid back, she'd changed and become a cat whenever Becky didn't back off. It led to a lot of fighting and a lot of awkward moments. Sorry, Sammy said and gave Becky a hug, who in return grabbed me, pulling me into their embrace as well. I'm sorry too. I know I'm a hard ass, but I hate seeing you guys like this. It's just difficult, I said. Sammy, you know exactly who you are. I just found out. I don't know how to be a dragon. I meant it when I said that I didn't like the way she makes me feel. How on earth did I become a Rubicon? They both started to laugh. Becky let go of Sammy, but kept her arm wrapped around my neck. Ever since you came here, mystery was written all over your face. It's time you just went with the flow, girl. Easier said than done. No, somehow you always find a way to just be okay with everything. You'll see. Before you know it, you'll be just as badass as Sammy. That's what I'm afraid of, being a badass dragon. Seriousness laced my tone again. I didn't mean it like that, Becky said, shaking her head. I'm a Rubicon, Becky. I'm going to turn evil, too. It's just a matter of time. Over my dead body, Sammy said. Mine, too. What if I need the beatings, too? You know what? Let's not speculate, please. We'll deal with it if we get there, Becky said. We all nodded. It was quiet for a few seconds before Sammy chuckled. Now I finally get why my brother was so into you whenever he was drunk.
It was her that drew him closer. I didn't feel hungry that night, skipped dinner and went to bed early. My dragon form really drained my energy. When I walked into the cafeteria the next morning, everyone stared at me. Even a few Dragonians whispered about trying to claim me. I rolled my eyes at that piece of information, as if I was going to be an easier claim than Blake. If they knew her the way I was starting to, they wouldn't be thinking that. Around 10, Master Longway's voice came from the speaker system.
Elena Watkins, come to the office, please.
Professor Pfizer, who'd helped us with developing our abilities while we were in human form, nodded, and I packed my books and left. She wasn't so helpful anymore, and even limited her advice, but I still saw the question in her eyes of what I was whenever I found her staring at me. She would look away, of course, but my dragon's sight was a lot faster than hers. Sometimes that second that our eyes met felt like minutes before she dropped her gaze. It was hard to explain. I just felt different. I found Master Longway behind his desk, and he gestured with his hand to the chair in front. I took a seat. He steepled his fingers in front of his mouth.
You need help, Elena.
I huffed. What's new? His lips curved into a smile and he dropped his hands as he moved his chair underneath his desk. He took a deep breath and let it out slowly.
Blake has agreed to help you find your dragon.
I froze. What? Blake had actually agreed to help someone else besides himself? Latin jumped into my mind, and I shook my head at the words from the last conversation that had taken place between Master Longway and Blake, right here in his office, after my secret had been revealed. No, it's fine. I'll make peace with her some other way.
Elena, the two of you are from the same species. It won't be anything like your Latin lessons. I promise.
I laughed. How do you know? Did he say so? For all I know, it could be his way of getting closer to me and killing me off. Two Rubicons can't live together in this world. You know that.
He gave me his word that he would not hurt you. He wants to figure this out as much as you do, Elena. And I promise you, he doesn't want to kill you.
Just like the way Paul promised you? It just slipped out, but I didn't regret it. Lucian had died because of that choice. Master Longway's eyes froze at my words, and he looked away.
I was fooled. It is a mistake I'll never make again.
I took a deep breath. I probably don't have a choice, do I?
Not this time.
Fine. Where do I meet him? He raised his eyes and looked as if I hadn't just offended him only seconds ago.
That's up to the two of you. I'm only the messenger.
You mean I have to hunt him down and ask him? Fine. Thanks. I wasn't thankful, really. I didn't want to spend time with Blake any more than he wanted to spend time with me. I hated how he made me feel. Sometimes I felt like a toy. He was always there, except the last time, when I was in danger. But afterward, he would push me away as if he hadn't just saved my ass. It was a frustrating little game, and one I really didn't have the time or energy for anymore.
Have fun.
He smiled awkwardly.
Not too much, though.
For some reason, I wanted to snicker at his sentence. I'd always wondered if Master Longway could read minds, as if Blake and I would ever have fun. Nothing had changed. He was still the arrogant bastard he had been a few months ago.
At lunchtime, Sarah gave me a note. She offered me a genuine smile when she handed it to me, and I stared at Sammy, who just shrugged. Sarah was part of Tabitha's group, and they despised me as much as Blake did. I put the note in my pocket without reading it. I wasn't in the mood to find out what Tabitha or Sarah wanted from me now. I eventually took out the note during enchantments. The class was different from human magic, but just as hard, as all the incantations involved connection spells. Dragons couldn't do magic in their dragon form, although they were magical creatures. But there was always a loophole to this whole magic thing, and that was what we had to learn, how to harness it. The hard part was that they were still in Latin and my dragon was English. Nothing made sense at all. I squinted as I looked at the horrible handwriting. I'd thought Lucian's was bad. An ache, just from thinking his name, jolted through my body. I put down the note and wished with all my heart that I could just let go of all this pain and cry. But the tears were still absent from my cheeks. I opened the note again and struggled with the first word. I finally knew who'd written it when I made out the word meet and something like mountain. I sighed and chucked the note back into my pocket as the bell rang. This isn't going to work, I thought, as I threw my backpack over my shoulder and left the classroom. I found Blake with his arm around Tabitha's neck below the staircase as I walked out. He looked different and cooed disgusting words of what he was going to do to her later on into her ear. It was times like these that I didn't want to be a dragon. The first thing I noticed was his broad smile. Blake never smiled like that. Although it was breathtakingly beautiful, it was sort of creepy at the same time. You have terrible handwriting, I interrupted their little moment. Just tell me where you want me to meet. He smiled at me.
There's a mountain right behind the...
He stopped and just stared at me for a short while. I, of course, stared back and gave him slightly raised eyes and a what shrug.
What is it, Elena? Why the long face?
How do you suppose I get to that mountain, Blake?
You can fly.
His tone was sarcastic. You really think that Ms. Hyde is going to remember to meet you there? Because I can promise you, she won't.
Then I'll just have to hunt you down,
he said in a flirty way. My eyes found Tabitha's, and I knew she'd heard it too, as her jaw muscles twitched. She glared at Blake. My heart beat a little faster. For once, Tabitha and I had something in common, and it wasn't fighting for Blake's heart. Forget it. I'll make peace with her on my own terms. I didn't need another Ariana on my case.
Elena,
he called after me, but I kept walking. Tabitha was protesting, and it would be just my luck if she hadn't known about this little arrangement at all.
Would you slow down?
He was right behind me.
Why do you want to help me all of a sudden, Blake?
My tone was harsh.
I have my reasons, and once you're ready, I promise I'll share them.
He raised his eyes and smiled again. What was it with him and all this grinning? It didn't suit him.
Fine, whatever. But I'm not flying to some stupid mountain, I mumbled.
Then meet me behind the Parthenon Dome,
he said abruptly, and walked off in a different direction.
What time?
When he turned around, I flapped his note. Couldn't decipher that one either. He chuckled.
At 2.
2? Master Longway hadn't been kidding when he'd said it wouldn't be like Latin. I really wondered what Blake was going to get out of this. 3. I had 5 minutes after the last bell of the day rang to get ready for my meeting with Blake. His sudden change in behavior still lingered, and I still didn't trust the help he was offering. Ever since I'd come to Paegeia, Blake had developed a deep hatred toward me, and now he treated me as if I was his favorite type of jello. But maybe Master Longway was right. Maybe Blake did have some answers for me, because he was exactly like me. At 2, I ran down to the Parthenon Dome. I waited in the front and should have known it was some sort of prank when he wasn't there by 4:15. As I stood there waiting, a deep growl sounded from the back of the dome, and I went to investigate. I almost jumped out of my skin as I turned the corner to see a huge purple-red dragon with sprouts all over his face, lying on his belly like a cat. He grunted. "I didn't know you were here, okay?" I said, but I knew it was useless, as he didn't understand a word I was saying. He shook his head, and it made a huge whooshing sound as it whipped through the air. He got up, and I had to arch my neck back to look at him. He sure was one ugly bugger. But at the same time, he was so damn beautiful, as the sun sparked off the different colors of his scales. He stretched his back, and I had to suppress my laughter as his huge butt rose into the air. Well, at least I wanted to laugh again. He darted upward and took off, but not before grabbing me in his hulking talons. I let out a cry as I dangled upside down, and another left my lips as he flipped me over in the air and caught me in his palm. "Are you crazy?" My heart hammered a million beats a minute as a deep chuckling left his belly. "Hell no, you didn't just laugh at me." I felt like kicking the inside of the huge paw that carried me like an egg in a basket. But I didn't, as I was afraid he would drop me. I closed my eyes as I clung onto one of his talons. The speed at which we flew was crazy, and it reminded me of the elevator again. My stomach dropped with the way he ducked and dove. Silently, I wished he would stop fooling around and fly straight like a normal dragon. But then again, Blake was far from normal. He opened his paw, and I landed with a hard thud on the cold ground. My heart rate refused to slow, as the image of him dropping me in midair and forcing me to transform played round and round in my head. I would have incinerated his ass.
"Wasn't that fun?"
His voice broke through my thoughts, and I was too scared to open my eyes because I knew I would find him naked. He chuckled as if he could hear my thoughts.
"I've got a robe on, Elena. It's safe to open your eyes," he mocked.
I didn't want to open my eyes yet, as my head still spun like crazy and bile was stuck in my throat. Oh, crap. I was going to... The thought hadn't even properly formed in my head before I got onto all fours, crawled to the nearest tree, and vomited.
"Was it that bad?"
He sounded sincere as he crouched beside me. "It's not that. Believe me, this is an Elena thing," I mumbled.
"I would love to hear about it."
I gave him a look and saw he had a wet cloth in his hand. I took it and wiped my mouth. How did he know I was going to throw up? "Something tells me you already know," he chuckled.
"I don't. I just came prepared."
"I'm afraid of heights," I said softly.
"Sorry."
"Oh, you heard me." My tone was harsh again. "I'm afraid of heights."
"How is that even remotely possible?"
His eyebrows rose slightly and he was clearly struggling to suppress his smile. "Go ahead, laugh," I snapped. "I don't know. It's the way it is. I've always had this fear of heights thing going on." I ducked my head in between my legs and took deep breaths.
"You serious?"
"Yes, always have been."
"But you're a dragon."
"So sue me," he chuckled.
"You're really funny in a messed up way. You always this pissed?"
No, it somehow seems to come out whenever you're around. He laughed again. I took a deep breath. His happy-go-lucky attitude was really starting to piss me off.
First rule,
he said, and I knew my resting was over. He was so much like Lucian.
Whatever you do, don't fall in love with me.
Excuse me? I squinted at him.
You heard me,
he said through a huge smile. Oh, that ego. Don't flatter yourself. I'm not one of those diddle bags that buff their eyes every time you come near. He smiled, and the tip of his tongue licked his upper teeth. I had to admit, it was sexy in some crazy way. I shook that thought out of my head. What the hell was he trying to do? Prove me wrong?
Second rule.
He turned around to face me again.
You need to deal with being naked, Elena.
Fat chance, Mr. Ego.
Elena, you are a dragon. All dragons are used to being naked.
Well, not this one.
Good.
He nodded. What's good?
You finally acknowledge yourself as a dragon. I can work with that.
I raised my eyes and upper lip in a sarcastic way and looked down at the ground.
Why don't you like her?
Because I don't remember the shit she does. I can't control her and I always end up wanting to kill one of my friends.
That will change the more you bring her out, Elena.
I can't promise that she won't hurt you. He laughed again.
I can handle a little female Rubicon.
I huffed sarcastically. She's different.
She doesn't have my experience.
Fine. Just don't fall in love with her, please. He laughed again.
Glad we have one rule in common.
He smacked both hands together hard.
Get her out, Elena.
My lips vibrated as I blew out air. I'd forgotten my robe and flinched.
It's going to be fine. I promise.
I don't even understand one word you are saying, Blake. She doesn't speak Latin.
Let me worry about that. I'll work something out.
I forgot my robe. I finally admitted what I was really scared about. He chuckled again, went to the backpack I didn't even know he had with him, and pulled out another robe.
I told you, I always come prepared.
I grabbed the robe and walked with huge strides to the biggest tree I could find and pulled off my clothes. I pulled on the robe that was way too long for me and that smelled like Blake. His fragrance lingered on the fabric as if he'd just emptied an entire can of his scent. It smelled amazing. I lifted it from the ground and walked back to him. We just stood in front of one another for a short while as I contemplated bringing her out.
I really need to meet her, Elena.
I bit my lower lip. She makes everything feel 10 times worse, Blake. I begged.
It's normal. You've got to embrace her.
Fine. Turn around. He gave me a blunt look. Turn around.
Seriously?
I grabbed both his shoulders and turned him around. I took off my robe when I was sure he wouldn't look and closed my eyes as I crouched. I rested my head on my knees and let my emotions take over. Anger usually did the trick, but the ache of missing Lucian was more potent. I welcomed it and thought about him like I used to. His smile, the way his look made me feel. For the love of blueberries, I missed him so much. I could feel the change. The pull and the tear. The jolt of pain shot through me as my limbs grew and my butt stretched out into a tail. When I opened my eyes, Blake was really small, and he was still turned away from me. He started to turn his head, and for some reason, I was calmer than usual. He just looked up at me.
Hi, I'm Blake.
I sighed. It's still me, idiot.
I thought you said,
It takes a couple of minutes. Just wait. He smiled.
I don't know why you don't like her, Elena.
You'll spin another story once you meet her. He smiled, and I lowered my head onto my paws and closed my eyes, waiting for her to come out. Kara. I opened my eyes, scared of where I was going to find myself. My body felt fine, and when I lifted my head, I was someplace completely different. How the hell did I get here? I had to admit it was a peaceful place, and the view would take any dragon's breath away. Something cleared its throat below me, and I looked down. I found another rodent. I got up onto my paws and was ready to breathe a blast of fire when he lifted his hands in defense. Calm down, Elena. Who the hell is Elena? I'm not Elena. He squinted his beady little eyes. Who are you, then? Name is Kara. Kara? His one eyebrow raised, then a smirk ran over his face. Fine, I'll go with that. You are? I should be incinerating him, not speaking to him. I opened my mouth again. Wait, he said, and his arms and hands were up in the air. I'm like you, okay? I laughed. You are nothing like me, little rodent. She wasn't joking when she said that you are feisty. Who are you talking about? Elena, she's in there with you. He laughed again. I'm sure you'll meet her soon. Was this little rodent mocking me? I have nobody inside of me. The words rolled down like poison. He laughed again. He was so arrogant, and it was annoying the hell out of me. Without another thought, I took my talon and flicked him off the mountain. Good riddance. I closed my eyes again for a few seconds and looked at the view. The sun baked my scales, but the weather was changing. There was a cold breeze in the air that made me shiver. Just as my eyes wanted to close, a huge, ugly mother spoiled the view, and I got up, turned around, and bolted through the trees to find another escape off this mountain. I could hear its flapping above my head as I changed direction. I guessed the trees falling down didn't really help my escape plan so much. I found an edge and hurled myself off the cliff. The wind supported my wings and lifted me higher into the sky. I still didn't trust them because for some reason they didn't feel as if they belonged to me. I spotted the other dragon in the distance. It was really big, and I darted in the direction furthest away from it. When I looked back to see where it was, I found nothing. Then I felt something warm and wet dripping down my face. It had a tingling sensation, and when I looked up, the mutt was right above me. I darted down and struggled for the next half hour to shake the dragon from my tail. My new body was faster, and I loved every minute of this speed. The dragon was still on my tail, though, and something was telling me that it was much faster than it had revealed so far. I stopped in midair, and it darted past me like a rocket. It stopped, too, when it saw me, and I knew this was it. If we had to fight to the bitter end, then so be it. What do you want from me? I bawled, and the dragon cocked its head, turned around, and flew back toward the mountains. I should go in the opposite direction, but for some reason I followed. It was difficult to keep up as the beast accelerated. It turned into a fun game of follow my lead, and I was surprised I could do everything this mutt could do. The rodent from the mountain jumped into my head. Could it be him? But Mama said, this Elena, was she my human form? I remembered it now, and I forgot to flap as bits and pieces of my old life came back. I had been waiting for my human form. What happened? Why was I asleep for such a long time? I struggled to regain my balance, so Mama and what she'd said had to wait. When I looked down, the ground came nearer and I couldn't stop. Huge talons grabbed me and threw me higher into the air. I landed with a thud and found myself on top of the ugly mutt's back. I didn't want to fight anymore. As I could hear his heartbeat jumping through his chest and vibrating right through my body. Something about this dragon reminded me of someone else. Something I'd forgotten. Papa. Elena. I heard a thought, a voice, and felt an emotion of missing someone as much as I missed Lucian.
Papa.
I thought immediately of my dad, and when I opened my eyes, I found myself on a dragon's back, but I was still in my dragon form. Oh, crap. What had happened now? I closed my eyes again as the horizon started to seesaw. My head twirled. I was on Blake's back, and I knew who he was. It was a first, as it usually took a short while before that part came back. He was right, the more I brought her out, the faster I would get used to her. I was dying for the memories to return, and I hoped she'd breathed some fire on his ass, made him work a bit to get her attention. That thought made me smile. And I was sure a dragon could smile as I felt the corners of my lips curving upwards. The word Papa jumped into my head again. The feeling was familiar. Did my dad fly with me like this when I was little? Was that what my dragon form remembered? Blake landed back on the mountain with a heavy thump. I slid, fell off his body, and landed with a thud on the ground. He changed back in a few seconds, and I closed my eyes again, waiting for him to put on his robe.
Why did you fall?
Just give me a couple of minutes and I'll remember, I said sarcastically. He smiled.
You're back.
What happened?
I'll give you a couple of minutes.
Ha ha, you are so hilarious.
You can change back now, Elena. I still don't know why you don't want to embrace her.
I sighed. Please, don't tell me you actually liked her. He chuckled as he took a cigarette out of his backpack. You still smoke?
Yes,
he said in a it's got nothing to do with you tone. Gently, I grabbed the robe that lay on the ground with my teeth and went into the woods again. One side of the mountain's trees were completely destroyed, lying broken on the ground. I so didn't want to know what had happened between them. I took a deep breath, followed by another, and started to think about my human form the way Sammy and Constance had taught me. A tingling feeling told me that the change was close, and I could feel a very stuffed feeling as my dragon body tried to push itself back into my human form. When I opened my eyes, I looked at my hands and saw fingers covered with human skin. I sighed. Finally, I'd managed to do that without any help whatsoever. I pulled the robe over me and went to Blake. He stared at me for a bit. What now? I said, hoping my boobs weren't hanging out.
Your hair.
I grabbed my ponytail. It was still fine. My hand went automatically to my head, hoping I wouldn't find it bald. It was still covered with hair. He got up and pulled out my pony. What are you doing?
Look, Elena.
He pulled a big strand over my face, and I saw what he meant. The hairs weren't blonde anymore, but a soft color of the rainbow. Please don't tell me I'm going to turn into that rainbow dragon next, I sighed. I grabbed the rest of my hair.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.